With our abstract class done, we can now create our player movement state machine. This state machine will of course take care of all of the player movement states. To create it, in Unity, go back to the scripts folder and create a new folder named characters. Then inside, create another one named player. Inside of that player folder, we'll have yet another folder named state machines, followed by another folder named movement. In there, create a new C# script to which I'll name player movement state machine. Open it up and remove the default methods and swap the mono behavior inheritance with state machine instead. This state machine can now be used to change between player movement states and run their logic. Of course, we don't really have any state yet as we still need to create them. Before we do that though, let's first take a look at the differences between caching states or instantiating new states. Whenever we call our change state method, we need to pass in our new state. We can do this by either creating a new instance of the new state class every time we change states, or create it once and cache that instance in our state machine. Creating a new instance every time we change states ensures that if a state isn't being used, resources won't be wasted unnecessarily, as it will be removed. Caching the instance will always have resources like memory being used, as the instance is still needed and won't be automatically removed, but you won't need to instantiate new states every time. One thing to note here as well is that creating a new instance always creates the variables again, so their values will be reset to their initial default values, while caching the instance will always have them the way they were. Although I don't think it will matter for us too much. Now, which we should use depends in our use case. When a state will be entered quite a lot, then caching it might be a good idea. Let's take the example of the player jumping. It's extremely common for someone to keep pressing the jump button while roaming around the map. This means that the player state will be changed to the jumping state quite a lot, which makes it a good reason to cache that state instead of instantiating it every time. Now let's take an example of an NPC which has 2 or 3 states that only get changed every 30 minutes. For example, one will be idling, another one will be walking around, and another one will be talking with another NPC. Because they only change every so often, there isn't much reason to keep them cached, and will probably be better for us to create a new instance at every state change, or every 30 minutes. This would also make it if there were 100 NPCs in the map, we wouldn't have 300 states cached in, although we would have 100 states being instantiated every 30 minutes. Of course, you can mix both usages if you prefer. For our player, however, we'll be caching in all of our states. Now that we know that, let's start by creating our first movement states. We'll start with the moving states without the group state, but including the idling state, and the movement state as well, as that will be our base state. So, back in Unity, in the same folder, create a new folder named states. Inside, we'll create a new C# script to which I'll name player movement state. When that's done, create another folder named grounded for our grounded states. Inside, create a new C# script named player idling state. When you are done doing that, create yet another folder named moving for our moving states. Inside, we'll create 3 new C# scripts. Player walking state, player running state, and player sprinting state. When you are done creating them, go back to folders and open up the player movement state script. Remove the default methods and swap the mono behavior inheritance with an iState interface implementation. If you are using an IDE, it should show an error that says that we should implement the interface methods. So I'll press Alt-Enter and implement them. To make it easier for us to know what state the player is currently in, we'll log the current state class name in the enter method. To do that, type in debug.log and pass in state concatenated with getType.name. This will show the name of the correct class type. Other options like typeof or nameof will always show the parent class name. When that's done, we want to make sure we can override these methods with their own logic in each state. So we'll need to add the virtual keyword to every single one of the methods. Then we'll open up all of the other four states we have created and remove their default methods, making sure we swap their inheritance from mono behavior to player movement state as well. We now have our initial states, so we can start caching them. To do that, head back to the player movement state machine script. Remember that we'll only need to cache in states that are not considered group states. This is because the player will never be in the player movement state, but instead on the idling state or running state, as the movement state simply exists to group common logic. So start by typing in public player idling state idling state. I'll make it a property with an omitted set. In case you are wondering, here are the differences between writing private set or simply omitting the set. If you don't want to think about it, simply make it private for all properties that don't use a public set. Duplicate this property 3 times and swap their names to be walking, running, and sprinting. We now of course need to instantiate each one of them, so create a constructor by typing in public player movement state machine and inside simply type in idling state equals to new player idling state. Do the same thing for all of the other 3 states. Our states are now cached. That's great, but you have likely noticed we aren't yet calling any of the state methods in any monobehavior class, which means their logic will never run when we start playing the game. To do that, we need to first create that monobehavior class. So, back in Unity, go all the way back to the player folder and create a new C# script. I'll name it player. Opening it up, remove the default methods. All we need to do now is to create an instance of our state machine and call its methods. To do that, create a new private variable of type player movement state machine, which I'll name movement state machine. We now have the constructor, change state, handle input, update, and physics update methods to call. We'll call them in the awake method, the start method, the update method, and the fixed update method. In the awake method, we'll need to create a new instance of our state machine. So type in movement state machine equals to new player movement state machine. In the start method, we need to define the player starting state. We'll start our player in the idling state. To do that, type in movement state machine dot change state and pass in movement state machine dot idling state. Our player shall now enter the idling state whenever the game starts. In the update method, we'll need to handle our input and run our non-physics related logic. So call in movement state machine .handleInput and movementStateMachine.update. The order is important as we want to make sure we've got our input data updated before we do anything with it in the update method. In the fixed update method, we'll need to run our physics-related logic, so call in movementStateMachine.physicsUpdate. We are now running our current state logic through our player script. Of course, this will never happen unless we add this script as a component of the player. So head back into Unity, select the player game object, and add the player script as a new component. If we now go ahead and enter play mode, a debug.log shall be called saying that the player is in the idling state.